And Philippine economic planners are now busy drafting an economic recovery plan ahead of the end of the enhanced community quarantine. With us now for more is Acting National Economic and Development Authority Director General Carl Kendrick Chua. Good to see you, DG Carl. Welcome to the program.
Good morning, Kathy, and our viewers. Yes. Apologies for the slight delay in this interview.
Not at all.
It's been a very busy transition period for me.
On the appointment.
Thank you.
I understand.
Thank you very much.
So what do you make of the inflation result? Coming in at 2.2% for April, that's 2.6% year-to-date, a five-month low.
Well, you know, inflation is a collection of the various prices, and we see that we basically have ample supply for our basic essentials. That's also driven by the sharp decline in global crude prices, but also that we are proactively also managing our inflation expectation well. So I think this is very good indication of where we are headed.
But what are the risks of a renewed pickup in inflation if we put in global rough rice prices? They're up about 20% since March this year because of the COVID-19 disruptions to labor and panic buying.
Well, you know, the important thing right now is we have to make sure that our supply is not disrupted. So we have had several cases wherein food supply or other essential goods have not been able to pass through as the local governments impose stricter quarantine or checkpoints. So we will have to make sure the supply chain is not disrupted so that we can continue this pace of inflation that is low and stable.
So is the government going to do anything in addition to what it is doing now to ensure that our rice supply is not disrupted?
Well, we have adequate stocks, and we have a program called the Rice Competitiveness Enhancement Fund, which is basically to ensure and help farmers improve productivity. So we will have to implement that at a faster scale. We are now also seeing 2/3 of the country under the general community quarantine. So farmers can work, the supply chain can be more efficient. So I think all these will help ensure that we have low and stable inflation.
How can you speed up the rice competitiveness enhancement there?
Well, you know, the next planting season is about to start in June or July, and our harvest is around October. So the important thing now is to deliver what the rice tarification law promised. So the seeds, the equipment, all the support system. So I think this is the right time to deliver as farmers begin to prepare for the planting season.
In about 48 hours, we're going to be getting the first quarter GDP result that is out on Thursday. What is that likely to reveal partially about this lockdown that began midway through March?
Well, you know, Kathy, we have to first begin with the context. We entered the year 2020 at a very strong economic foundation. We have seen consistently high growth rates above 6%. Our inflation is very low and stable. We are also seeing strong international reserves. Our credit rating is BBB plus, or one notch below the A rating. And not only that, we are seeing very strong social economic indicators. We have the lowest poverty, unemployment, and underemployment rates as we enter 2020. And a big part of that is because of the big infrastructure program in the last 3.5 years. Unfortunately, in 2020, January, we were hit by continuous shocks of increasing magnitude. So Taal volcano eruption in an area where 50% of the GDP is located, followed by the decline in tourism and trade because of the global pandemic starting in China. And in March, we took the decision to impose ECQ because we wanted to make sure that we can care and provide care for our people and beef up our health system capacity. So all of these will weigh in on the GDP numbers. But the context here is we are starting the year with a very strong footing. So let's see in the next 48 hours where we are headed.
Yeah, you know, I spoke with Governor Ben about 24 hours ago on this same program, and he said GDP for all of 2020 is tipped to register negative growth of 0.8% because of the extension of the ECQ. Is that what you're forecasting as well?
Well, that is the official Development Budget Coordination Committee forecast. So from zero or flat growth to minus 0.8. And that was based on the assumption that the ECQ would be for 1 or 2 months. Now, the good thing is we have started to see much progress in our health system, and the number of cases have actually slowed down. In fact, if you look at the numbers you showed earlier, there are more recoveries than deaths, more than double. So this is a good sign. Two-thirds of the country are beginning to move from the ECQ to the GCQ, or general community quarantine. So basically that opens a lot of our economy, except the non-essentials, open for business. So I think this is a good sign that we are slowly getting towards a recovery. And you know, Kathy, the most important thing is we don't want to make the mistake right now of opening up the economy because we want high growth. We have to be careful about a possible second or third wave if we don't make the right decision based on science and facts. So other countries are seeing a second resurgence, so we don't want to make that mistake.
So knowing what we do now, what will be the proper means of going forward to prevent the second or third wave?
Well, you know, the enhanced community quarantine does not really solve the problem. It only buys us time. And we have used that time wisely to increase our health capacity. So we have seen gradual increase in testing, although that could be still accelerated. We are putting more efforts on ensuring our health workers have personal protective equipment, ventilators, ICU beds, testing areas, swabbing areas. These are all in the works. So that is the first thing we have to do, to ensure that when we do partially open up, we are ready. And the LGUs, especially the far-flung provinces, are also ready to cope once we have more mobility. So that is the first. The second is we are continuing our social amelioration program and our business small business wage subsidy to help the workers who have been put out of work because of the ECQ or the GCQ. We are also now working with Congress to prepare our recovery program, and that will be how we will transition back to hopefully pre-crisis growth rates and employment rates, and also how we adapt to the new normal.
Would we be ready by May 15th to transition out of the ECQ?
Well, we are looking at the data on a day-to-day basis. In fact, if you remember, the initial announcement of our spokesperson was later revised. And the reason for that is every day we see new data. Some areas develop higher risk, some areas improve. So we should continue to monitor this. And I think we have a very good model to look at case doubling time and also the critical care utilization capacity to basically make a decision on which areas we will eventually relax and which areas we will have to put in some more stringent quarantine. So the idea here is we use data and science real time as much as possible to make that informed decision.
So how much would the equivalent economic losses in pesos be of a negative 0.8% growth? Because you had earlier said the economy could sustain 1.1 trillion pesos in losses because of the lockdown, but that's assuming growth is flat.
Well, a flat growth basically means that we will see losses of up to 1.1 trillion pesos. We, of course, do not know what will happen in the next 8 months, because you know, we are looking at GDP and the context today. Things may change. If we have a V-shaped recovery, things may improve. What we actually did, Kathy, in the last 1.5 months was to commission 3 surveys. One for consumers, and we have more than 300,000 respondents. The second is for micro, small, and medium enterprises. We have 44,000 respondents. And the third one is for agriculture and farmers, where we got 8,000 respondents. And basically what the survey suggests is that the ECQ has led to significant closures, which is expected because only a fourth or less of firms can open, those under essentials. They said that they suffered some losses equivalent to around 700 billion, and that's also not surprising, and that up to 60 to 70% of workers are out of work temporarily. So these are some of the indicators that we are using to prepare a more targeted recovery program that really addresses the concerns of the businesses and the people.
So how many jobs do you think have been lost because of COVID-19?
Well, you know, our estimate came from the Department of Labor and Employment. That's around 1.2 million as of last month. We are continuously monitoring the numbers as we speak. So the good news is two-thirds of the country's LGUs are now in general community quarantine, meaning more and more people can work. So we are monitoring this on a daily basis. We are providing a 51 billion wage subsidy to employees of small businesses to help them cope over these 2 months of quarantine.
So coming out of all the levels of restrictions, from enhanced community quarantine to general community quarantine, what do you think will be the new normal facing the government?
Well, you know, the new normal basically is what we have to deal with until a vaccine is discovered or found. It basically means we have to avoid mass gathering. So conferences probably will not be high in the priority or not even allowed. Meetings will have to be as much as possible spaced. We will have to rely on digital technology to transact, less face-to-face transaction with government and the private sector, more online meetings, online transaction, online payment, online filing. So these are things that the government has started and the private sector also, and we need to just basically accelerate and make sure these are available. The second is we have to invest a bit more in our health infrastructure. We have to invest a bit more on water and sanitation and adequate housing so that people can feel safe even in their homes. So these are some of the things that we have to expect in the new normal.
All right. And what role do you see the private sector playing in that recovery plan under the new normal?
Well, a very big role, because this is a once in a century problem. We didn't have this since 1918, and the magnitude is much bigger. So this requires an all-nation approach to addressing this problem. So people who think the government has a solution and a perfect solution for the problem, I think, are not attuned to the reality. This is where private sector will have to contribute in terms of supplying the right equipment to help the health sector, supplying and facilitating testing, of course, also taking and making sure their employees are safe when we do resume work. So that's a lot of work that needs to be done jointly with the private sector.
And a lot of money. So would you be needing fresh money for this recovery plan?
Well, a lot of financing is needed, because for 3 months, we are not really collecting from the private sector. We have deferred a lot of the tax filing and payments. We have also deferred payment of loans, rental. The good news is, Kathy, we are starting, as I mentioned, this year with a very strong fiscal position. Our credit rating is BBB+, and that is one notch below the A rating. And this is the result of continuous effort of succeeding administrations to solidify economic fundamentals and to be responsible fiscally. Our debt to GDP ratio for the first time hit below 40%. So the revised and rebased GDP applied to the debt numbers in 2019 showed the lowest ever recorded debt to GDP ratio of around 39%. So basically, we have a lot of room, and we have responded quickly with over ODAs, official development assistance. We have a very strong debt management strategy. So while we need financing, these are not difficult to get.
Well, the House of Representatives is preparing measures that seeks to allot some 1.3 trillion pesos in economic stimulus to help the economy recover. What do you make of it?
I haven't seen the details of that, Kathy, but I've had several discussions with House and House leaders and congressmen and the Senate. So, in principle, we agree with what they are proposing. We really need to help the people and the businesses recover. We also need to prioritize health, and we also need to prepare for the new normal. The main question basically is affordability. Nothing comes free from heaven. All of these will have to be funded, either from new taxes or financing options. And if we go for financing, it is basically asking our children and grandchildren to pay for this. So what we are in discussion right now is a way to provide the support and the help needed to the people and the business sector, while also maintaining our fiscal responsibility. So this is an ongoing discussion that we have.
Right, because it also has an impact on the country's budget deficit as it relates to GDP. So at what point would you say it might not be sustainable relative to GDP?
Well, you know, all countries are affected in this global pandemic. Countries like, I think, Japan and the US and some of our neighbors are already putting in a lot of money. And that is, of course, is affecting their deficit and debt level. The, you know, Kathy, the most important thing right now is we have to, if we do spend more to help the people, we have to spend it correctly. And we have to have a very credible downward path on our deficit and debt. And I think the international community will understand that. So long as we are seen as responsible and proactive in managing our fiscal position, and we have a clear downward trajectory on how we will manage this temporary uptick in deficit and debt.
Okay, so when it comes to the job losses, how does the government plan to address the local job losses? What would be the government's program to create more jobs, especially those who were displaced?
Well, the thing that we are doing right now is to provide 18 million poor families and low-income families with the social amelioration program that is about 205 billion pesos. We are also providing some amount to help OFWs who come back to the Philippines during this difficult time. We have a 51 billion wage subsidy that we are providing. So these are the temporary measures. Now, how do we move from temporary emergency measures to the recovery program? A big part of our success in the last 3.5 years is the Build, Build, Build program. For the first time in 2018, we exceeded 5% of GDP infrastructure spending. If you remember, 10 years ago, all the international agencies were asking us to increase that from less than 2% to at least 5%, and we've achieved that. And the most important outcome of that is that we have seen the lowest poverty rate. We lifted 6 million Filipinos out of poverty well in advance of the 2022 target. We have the lowest unemployment and underemployment rate. So the Build, Build, Build program will be an instrumental way to stimulate the economy. And the multiplier there is 2. So basically, if I spend 1 peso on Build, 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 the economy gets another 1 peso. So that will be important. We will, of course, also improve the competitiveness of our country. We are modernizing tax incentives. And in fact, we are going to proactively reach out to companies that are looking for relocation sites so that we can attract them and use them to create good jobs.
Now, the other important component to ensuring sound macroeconomic policies is the implementation of the national ID system. How are you getting on fast-tracking the registrations of 5 million people or households?
Well, when I started 2 weeks ago, the first thing I did was to meet the PSA and the council members on how to accelerate the national ID. The good news is we are already two-thirds complete with the procurement of all the systems. And, you know, some people want us to do it very fast, but, you know, no one has ever done a national ID to register 100 million or more Filipinos. So we have to do this right and properly. There's a lot at stake. We want it fast, but we also want the security. We want to ensure privacy. We want to deliver a system that is useful over the many years. So we will use this period of quarantine to complete the remaining procurement and development packages. Then when it is safer to go out, then we will resume the mass registration with all the health standards and social distancing in place. And the target is we will pursue the 5 million at least. But instead of just 5 million individuals, I'm in discussion with the PSA to register 5 million household heads instead, so that we provide more opportunities per family or household to be financially included, and so that with their ID, they can open a bank account and receive their subsidy or other social amelioration programs direct to their bank account. And that will minimize a lot of the problems we have seen regarding leakage or inefficiency or delayed distribution.
So how and when will the national ID system be implemented, the timeline for all of 107 million Filipinos?
The timeline that I have seen from the PSA is by 2022. And of course, Kathy, this is an ongoing process because every year our population is growing by 1 to 2 million. So we will complete, I think, the basic stock, meaning those existing in the Philippines by 2022 who are adults, basically. and we will continue to register the new ones to become adults over the years.
So for now, which industries and businesses or sectors are you going to be prioritizing or would need the most support from government post-COVID-19? Which ones have you identified?
Well, we basically asked them through the surveys, and we saw that in the survey, construction sector, tourism, these are some of the sectors that have been mostly affected. And, you know, the effect is not just March. As I mentioned, January, Taal volcano eruption and the decline of trade and tourism from China and other countries in February has started to affect them. So these are some of the examples that I think we will give more attention. And we will continue to do the surveys. In fact, every month we have enterprise level surveys to assess which are the sectors that we will have to prioritize and target our limited resources.
So would there be tax breaks or incentives as a form of relief or stimulus measures for these most vulnerable sectors?
Yeah, we are in discussion with Congress, but I think it will be a combination of targeted and time-bound tax incentives. There will be credit guarantees, and there will also be direct subsidies to their workers. So those are the combination of packages that we are ready to offer. But, you know, we can't help everyone. We will have to be very targeted in the way we help so that it's also fair.
So which tax reforms would the government prioritize after COVID-19?
Well, you know, we proposed in 2016 five or six packages. You know, it became six or seven because Congress passed partial, like tobacco separate from alcohol, amnesty separate from the terrain law. The good news is the revenue-raising part of the tax reform has already been completed. Terrain law, the higher excise taxes on cigarettes and tobacco, cigarette products and alcohol. The remaining packages are not meant to raise revenue, Kathy. They are meant to fix a system that is not fair, not efficient, and very complex. So package two, which is on tax incentives, seeks to lower income taxes for corporate while making the incentive system performance-based, targeted, time-bound, and transparent. And we think this is still relevant and can be adjusted to be more responsive to COVID. Package four is about harmonizing the 80 or so rates in passive income and financial taxes. And one good thing about it is we are lowering the very high withholding tax on interest income from as high as 20 or 30% for non-resident to just 15. So this will actually help deepen our capital market and allow us to borrow more in at cheaper rates to finance our recovery program. So these are, I think, worthy to pursue still, even under this new normal.
And what about the proposed CETIRA tax reform bill in the Senate? Senate Bill 1357, where foreign firms are given two options. Are you still in support of that, that an income tax holiday will be given for 2 to 4 years and then a special tax rate on gross income for 3 to 4 years? Would this bill make the country highly competitive still in the region?
I think so. And in fact, we are not doing much in the next 2 to 7 years. There is a sunset period where we do not touch the present incentives. And because of COVID, maybe we can consider slightly longer transition because people and firms have to adjust. But, you know, I think the core element of the fiscal incentives modernization is really right. And it is about having more performance-based, targeted, time-bound, and transparent incentives. So I think we should still pursue that. And once we have normalized, once the transition period is has been ended, then we can use the new system of incentives to even attract better investment. And you know, Kathy, this is not in isolation from the other things we're doing. We have to look at it as a package. Investors come not for tax incentives. They come for infrastructure, better logistics, more competitive labor market, liberalization. That is why we're pursuing the Public Service Act amendment and so many other things. So we have to look at this from this bigger perspective.
Well,
and they will come.
Let me pick up on infrastructure then, because you've described it as an important part of the recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic. A trillion pesos this year was supposed to be spent out of the total 8 trillion allotted for the program. Are you still sticking to those targets?
You know, these are now being reviewed by the Development Budget and Coordination Committee. What we are thinking right now is we have to be reprioritize our infrastructure program. We have to give more space to health infrastructure. We have to give more space to digital infrastructure, and those are important in the new normal. But we will continue to pursue a lot of the infrastructure program because that is an important element in our recovery. But we will have to do this while meeting the minimum health standard. We will have to, given the smaller fiscal space, though fundable, we will have to select the projects that have the most economic impact in terms of getting us back to pre-crisis growth rates and employment levels. We stand a good chance to completing a lot of the flagship programs, and we will pursue them in the next 2.5 years.
A final point, Carl, how long before we see the Philippine economy normalizing? Is it going to take 1 year, 2 years, or more?
You know, I've heard people saying that it could be a V shape. So we have a slump now and we recover by July or August. Some people say it's going to be W shape. So we recover, but we make a mistake. So we slump again before we recover again. Some people say it's a long U shape where we have several quarters of low growth or negative growth before a vaccine can be discovered and therefore bring us back. So, you know, my take on this is we can proactively determine or chart our trajectory by making the right decisions today and being proactive. And I think we started well with an ECQ. As I mentioned, ECQ does not solve our problem at all. It only buys us time. And what did we do with the 2 months under ECQ? We put a lot of money in beefing up our health system capacity. From having just a few hundred tests, we are targeting 10,000 tests right now. And that is significantly helping in the health outcomes. Instead of seeing 100,000 deaths, the deaths are very limited. And our hospitals are not very overcrowded. You don't see people and sick people in the street lining up or dying. We are providing all these. So by taking a very proactive stance today by ensuring we have fiscal and monetary policy in sync and ready to support the economy, I think we can chart our trajectory. And we will do this on a day-to-day basis because we will have to be adaptive and do it in a phased approach to respond to the needs that we are seeing.
So do you have a good chance for a V-shaped recovery?
Well, as I mentioned, there's a good chance, and we will use our policies today and proactively chart it.
All right. I thank you so much for this opportunity.
Thank you very
much. I know
you've
been a very busy person. Do keep safe and all the best in the task ahead of getting our economy back on track. Carl Chua, the Acting NEDA Director General.